Stephan, welcome. Really happy.
Thank you. I guess is this easier for you if I move over here? Like this? Okay, good. Since I got such a wonderful introduction, and there's an even more flattering one on YouTube, by the way, I skipped the introduction. I think this was already done properly. But it was all humble beginnings. Basically, I grew up in East Germany, in a city called Jena. Some of you may know it. And I was denied higher education. I was literally denied to even attend high school. It was fairly common. My parents were physicians. They didn't want to join the only party that was allowed. And like many other young people, we were sort of cut off from higher education. I was cut off from higher education. But I built electronics in my spare time, and basically in my basement. And I had a connection to the local university in Jena, to Friedrich Schiller University. And the deal there was I would build some electronics for them, and I would get some chips when I needed them. So the head of this department heard about this and said, this is impossible. He's so talented. I want him to go through some sort of education at the university so he can work in my lab, okay? So this way I became a lab technician that was specializing in physics. Yeah? So sort of it was a physics program, but a little shorter, not as long as the regular physics majors. And during that time, I built electronics for the university, and this was a trade, and I didn't have to attend certain lectures. So one day I got promoted to exhibit my one of the devices, a computer-controlled automated instrument. To exhibit it in Leipzig at the Messe von Morgen. It's called, I'm not sure if you ever heard this, but East Germany was sort of the a trade fair center of the Eastern Bloc, and in particular Leipzig with the Messe von Morgen. This is where they exhibited the high tech that the communism had to offer. So this is basically me on my booth showing this thing. Now, this was in 1989, during the weeks of the demonstrations in Leipzig. It was a very surreal situation because I was there during the day, and at night I was curious and I joined the demonstrators. And but also at night, the engineers at some of some of the other exhibitors, they would continue working on their, goods. And among other things, they had robots that would, do certain industrial tasks. And one was there to basically saw pens, and it ripped the pens apart all the time. It was so funny. So I could see this interesting picture that the GDR wanted to project, none of it really working, but people are trying, and then the demonstrations at night. And also during that week, the wall came down. And I basically took a train to Berlin at night and participated in the party and so forth. So this time really defined me because I thought about becoming an entrepreneur, at least starting a small company on the side. This is really what I wanted to do at the time. And initially, the first company I built was simply selling computers to whoever needed them, and we would build wire networks and do some custom programming and so forth. And that company I sold to start a company that would develop things again. That would basically be in software development. And we fell in love with Next. Does anybody know this? Okay, so next is relevant because it's basically Steve Jobs' brainchild. He had a brief stint where he left Apple because his new idea didn't really sit too well with the board of Apple at the time. So he sort of was fired, also left. He was sort of somewhere in between. And he developed this groundbreaking concept of a new workstation. And it is relevant because basically what's running your iPhones is next step. It's the operating system that's on there. It just got renamed. And for the developers who are doing iOS, this is the reason why the classes are called NS something in Xcode. Yeah? But what is relevant for e-commerce here, which is my career, is that this happened to be the platform that we played with and developed software on. Initially, we had the document imaging system called Archive 2000. We had a couple customers in East Germany mostly. And as soon as the US market leader in document imaging set up shop in Germany, we were basically toast. We couldn't sell it anymore because they had the sales force, they had marketing. It's just a very hard, it was a hard lesson. But, and this was sort of 1994, we began to explore e-commerce, and I will later get into how we did that. But in the context of Next, what's interesting is that the first e-commerce system was basically built on Next. And here are sort of this is myself in the middle with my co-founders, Carsten and Wilfried. And basically, we came together over Next. This was basically our passion. Now, I just got asked where the Intershop name came from. So basically, in 1994, we had a prototype of an e-commerce system running on a Next, basically in Jena, in our small office. And it took a couple of revisions to get it to a point where we felt it was ready for prime time. And then we needed a name. And I still don't know to date, I swear, I don't know who came up with the name because it was a party and everybody was very happy. But somehow I remembered it next day. I'm sure I didn't come up with it, but I remembered it the next day. And we had a prototype of this e-commerce software up and running. It ran in Jena, and we had a dial-up ISDN connection to University Dortmund, Unido, because hosting wasn't invented yet, okay? So, but it ran at something like 1 Deutschmark and 50 Pfennige per minute, so it was fairly expensive. And we basically put a catalog from a major distributor on it, so we had something like 20,000 items, PC part and the like, and but then we didn't have any advertising for it. So initially we got some word of mouth propaganda going in the universities, but we didn't feel it got enough attention. Our little catalog. So we decided to call for a press conference, and what happened was. Let me browse forward a little bit now. Okay, what happened was that nobody showed up, of course. Huh? We got a call like later in the afternoon. We had, by the time we had finished all the snacks and drank the water and so forth, we got a call from a journalist from Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, and he basically said, "Look, there's a big traffic jam on Autobahn A9. I can't move. I have to leave and basically spend some time in Jena until it's cleared. So I could stop by just out of curiosity." And we said, okay, great. So he was basically there. He was stuck in Jena. He listened to our story and he wrote this article, and this is basically on the front page of the business section, and it was fairly big, it's bigger than here. So, we got a lot of attention. And of course, the dial-up line was on all the time, very expensive. Yeah? So we kind of knew either we turn this whole thing off and stop shipping computer parts, or we have to get some financing from someone because we were essentially broke. We had a 500,000 Deutschmarks credit line with 17% interest on it from the Sparkasse in Jena, and it was maxed out. There was nothing, you know, no. So we basically said, okay, we return the favor to Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, and, you know, we just post an ad. And so we couldn't say that this is for our company, because then the bank would have seen that we are broke or looking for money. So we used a law firm, basically, as the front for it. We got about 60 responses. Almost all of them were money laundering or some other thing that Russians, and it was funny. Huh? But there was one response that said, okay, we are doing venture capital. We are a relatively new company. We are doing software for the first time. We have a small office in Leipzig now, and we want to talk to you. And pretty soon, two gentlemen sat in front of me and asked me funny questions like, is the shop really in this computer? And I said, no, it's in the internet. Anyways, so, but they kind of, they really liked what they saw, and they wanted to give us money. So at the time, I thought it would be a loan with maybe a little less interest than 70%, 17%. But essentially, they said, okay, we want to invest in your company. You don't have to pay the money back. And we give you as much as reasonable, but as much as you need. So, well, how much do you need? And I said, maybe $1 million. So at the end, they invested 1.4 in that round. And then another 2 million was sort of earmarked already for it. Then I got very bold and said, look, I need to spend some of this money in San Francisco because I can't get the people in Jena who know how to market this. And I said, okay, that's interesting. But we have a friend there who is also a VC. We can call him right now. So they called Burgess Jameson from Sigma Partners. And the guy basically grilled me in English, and I couldn't speak English. And years later, I found out he speaks perfect German. Yeah? But it was just his way of... Anyways, so we got money. And this is Gerd Köhler, who is still a VC in Germany. He's basically Creator Ventures, I think it's called now. But at the time, it was Technology Holding. Technology Holding later got sold to 3i. Yeah, so this is the place where InnerShop was invented, basically. It's a Vicar's Villa in Jena, beautiful town. And then, of course, I took the money and spent it foolishly in San Francisco. Literally, the first people I hired were people who spoke English and German, because this was my only way of communicating. So I learned English, basically, I didn't have time for proper English language education, but over time I figured it out. I have a little video that I recently got sent from a friend. I mean, he used like very old equipment to play it, and then he used an iPhone to film it, and he sent it to me. So the quality isn't great, but just want to give you an idea of how the R&D looked like in the villa in Jena. So let me see if I can... And I just keep talking while I hope you can see anything. So initially, the R&D team consisted of students who did this for free. And our compensation was basically that they could take a computer home that we bought. Yeah? Obviously, impossible these days, but back then, that was a treat. And over time, we were able to hire some, and basically, we had two levels in this Vicar's Villa. And we had made a decision to develop this into a piece of software that we could actually sell. So then there was a time from basically from 1996 until 1998, during which everything happened in warp speed, I have to say. So from having basically no product, no revenue, just a good prototype and a good idea, to a public company with significant revenues, it all happened in 2 years. One thing that I felt later was a mistake was that in 1998, we were set to go public at NASDAQ, and there was a couple months during which NASDAQ didn't, there were no IPOs for a couple of months during 1998. And sort of the investors got a little nervous, but the Neue Markt was in Germany was really hot, so we decided to list in Germany first and on NASDAQ later. Looking back, this was a mistake because we sort of became a German company that way. And you know, some of the things that we needed to stay ahead of the curve in the US, like US stock options and other things that they basically were no longer available to us. But nevertheless, it was a fantastic time. And you know, leading up to 2000, everything was just wonderful. We had every quarter, we had more revenue than in the last quarter. It was good revenue, mostly licensed. So things were great. Of course, at the end of 2000, the world changed, and in particular 2001, 2002, it became very difficult for not just for the dot-coms, but also for the supplier of technologies to establish businesses who would compete with dot-coms. Yeah? So, from 1999 on, our business changed somewhat in that we recognized only the big existing brands are going to be a sustainable market for e-commerce software for a long time. So we had developed a software called the third rewrite of the e-commerce software, and we got really good reviews from the analysts, and it sold really well. And in 2000, we sold a lot of this new product. But basically, when dot-coms such as eBay or Amazon didn't seem to be much of a threat anymore to, say, the autos of this world. They simply stopped buying. I mean, it's literally the pressure to also have a proper e-commerce strategy basically stopped. And with that, our new license revenues. I remember two situations very distinctly. I mean, one was in at the end of 2000, in 2000, new year of 2001, after the holidays, I basically boarded a plane in Frankfurt, and there was no trading, didn't start yet. And when I landed, by the time I landed in San Francisco, the company's value had declined by something like 70%, basically from 10 billion to something like 2.5, whatever. You know. And leading up to this, this was a couple of months earlier, this 10% drop, I experienced it in the following way. I was in a gym in San Francisco on a treadmill. It's a fancy gym called Pacific Athletic Club, so many entrepreneurs, investors, people who had come to some success with technology, they frequented this place. And so everybody was in a treadmill or in a whatever device, and they had screens everywhere with the news. And then when the trading started and the news broke, and there was a drop in, it literally happened in a couple of minutes. Yeah, one after another stopped working out. Yeah? They all basically saw their fortunes, vanishing. Some of them, of course, had exotic instruments in place that are not just declining by 10%, but, that was interesting. But maybe go back to this. So what happened next was basically that I spent the better part of the next 3 years just trying to make sure InnoShop survives. So we had four rounds of layoffs. We pretty much closed the US business down with the exception of a small sales and a support team. We sold a product line that we felt we couldn't market properly anymore. We basically increase the professional services business and so forth. So at the end of the day, and I invested back some money, at the end of the day, it was sort of stable, yeah? But it was not fun. But also during that time, I saw an interesting phenomenon, and that was that our customers who didn't want to buy software for quite some time, their revenues were growing, their online revenues were growing. And they had a hard time keeping up with the growth of their online revenues. And I felt that the business model wasn't right. The business model of selling a piece of software to a retailer that they often couldn't operate it properly, or it was very hard for them to find qualified IT staff to operate it properly. And then they would never be on the newest version and all these typical problems that come with licensed enterprise software. I had heard about Salesforce.com and was wondering whether this model could be applied to mission-critical software. You see, with Salesforce.com at the time, CRM, if it doesn't work, who cares? The customers can see it. Or at the time, they couldn't see it. Yeah? Only the salespeople, they had to make some notes on a notepad and maybe type it in later. But e-commerce is something that's customer-facing, and you know, it can't stop working. It has to continue to work, and it has to. There's unpredictable traffic. You never know what's going on if they do a promotion. Anyway, so I had this idea of using Linux for a mission-critical application for the first time, using blade technology and what's called grid. Now it's all called cloud. Everybody forgot about these old terms, but at the time there was no such thing in sight. And I tried within Intershop at the time to build that and to get support for it. And I knew we needed money for it, so we couldn't finance it internally. We needed some external investors. And it was basically impossible. So Neue Markt in Germany was closed. We were then listed at the basically regular Frankfurt Stock Exchange. The trading volume had more or less vanished, so it was extremely difficult to get the interest of institutional investors. So the 20 or 30 million I needed to build this, sort of a software as a service version, I couldn't raise. It was impossible. And so early 2004, I left and started Demandware, because I felt if I don't do this, then someone else would do it, and it's too good of an opportunity to pass on. So we went to the East Coast and West Coast to raise capital. At the time when I mentioned e-commerce, mostly the meeting was over, because there was a hangover effect from the 2000 dot-com crash. But eventually we found an investor in Boston whose entire partnership consisted of ex-software entrepreneurs, of which I knew half of them. Yeah? I had done business with them before. Yeah? So they looked at it, and it took a while. We needed to prove some things and do a survey and so forth. But eventually they said, OK, sounds good. We're going to finance this. And this is basically the founding team, so to speak, of Demandware at a restaurant, Legal Seafood, which is like 20 meters away from the VC. And this is the term sheet. Somewhere is the term sheet. One is the menu, the other is the term sheet. so then, 10 years fast forward, or not 10 years, 8 years, actually. Now, Demandware is obviously a public company. To give you just an idea of scale, it's sort of the market cap you can calculate yourself, but it's usually right now is around 2.7 billion, I think. Last year, I keep that number for later. I tell you that I give you a different context for the number. Yeah? But let's just say the platform processes a significant portion of the entire e-commerce on the planet. Yeah, and let me talk about this, because this is sort of interesting. In 2005, which is basically in early 2005, just a couple months after we got financed, we had a meeting where we wanted to set the mission, the vision, and the BHAG, the big, hairy, audacious goal for the company. Okay, So the idea I had was, if at one point in the future, you know, 15, 20 years out maybe, whatever, we could do a billion on the platform, that would be fantastic. Now they, in overall revenue for our brands. Yeah. Now, what, we had basically several people trying to leave the company because they thought I'm crazy. Yeah. What do you think the number is, or was, for last year? It's 10. Yeah. So Demandware basically operates one of the biggest platforms after Amazon. So it can be done. We had a really good business model, and the business model is basically one of shared success, where we wouldn't just leave customers alone with their IT problems. We'd basically provide them with a cloud-based e-commerce platform. We would listen to what they needed to operate their business. We would essentially get a share of revenue, and therefore we had a vested interest, everybody in the company had a vested interest to innovate for more revenue that our customers could have. And this entire model, not just a piece of it, yeah, but this model where we share in our customer success and do everything to make it accessible to them, knowing retailers aren't technologists, that was the secret sauce here. Now, I'm no longer in the management of the company since, you know, 4 or 5 years now. I've been chairman of the board for a while. I'm not doing this anymore. I have a fantastic management team, so it's all going rather well. So with that, when I'm bored, I'm working on new things. So it took a while to come up with a new idea, and I don't really want to talk about the idea because we are not ready to announce it yet. But instead, I want to talk about some disruptive innovations that, at least for e-commerce, provide an opportunity to innovate again. You know, one is payment. The current situation is that there's a couple hundred different payment gateways. Every e-commerce site seems to have its own, you know, preferred payment gateway. And, you know, because of the way, in particular, MasterCard created its franchise, everything is very fragmented. But if you look at what Apple Pay is doing, who here has been able to use Apple Pay somewhere? Okay, this is kind of, I handed my iPhone to Christoph, so I can't show you directly, but basically, you have to see it. You have to see it to believe. It's basically, instead of typing a form for billing address, shipping address, credit card number on a small screen, you can basically just indicate that you want to buy something, and then you confirm with the Touch ID. That's it. Yeah. iTunes has 800 million credit cards already stored, including you know, shipping, billing address, and all the other good things. So when you use Apple Pay for the first time, which has not been rolled out in Germany, that's probably the reason why you don't use it yet. But in the US, it's been rolled out, and it is a winner. If you use this for the first time, you really see it. You understand that this is groundbreaking. It is even better than you know, basically shopping online on a desktop PC. Yeah, it removes the Amazon monopoly on convenience, where you can use a single sign-on and a one-click buy and all that. It's also the first time this one-click buy patent has been challenged with something that's better than what Amazon had. So obviously, all the other players are scrambling to follow Apple's lead here. And so, you know, Google has been buying a couple of companies. And just announced Android Pay. PayPal is a little bit sleepy. It's a sleepy company a little bit when it comes to sort of payment innovation. But, you know, they got a wake-up call. And the user experience that Apple set a standard for is being copied by all the other big players. So I would assume that this entire area will change drastically. We'll basically have two or three really successful players in the front end, and maybe, you know, four or five platforms in the back end that are processing the actual payment, such as Stripe, Braintree, and Adyen. Logistics. There is a lot going on in logistics innovation, and it's all around last mile. For one thing, there's going to be logistics services provided by crowdsourced drivers. So what Uber is doing for passengers can, of course, always also be done for sort of last mile or courier type services. Where, in fact, I've seen there are some specialty providers in the U.S. that operate this model already, and I've seen Uber drivers with two or three iPhones, and they run Uber and then they run one or two other services that had nothing to do with moving passengers, but with shipping goods from, say, you know, a store to a to an address in a metropolitan area. We will see the drones for sure; they will happen. Amazon is working seriously on that. And we will eventually, in our lifetime, also see self-driving cars and other things that make logistics cheaper. And with cheaper and more reliable logistics, faster logistics, come a whole host of additional business models that aren't possible today because it takes too long to ship or it's too expensive. Computing, I mean, if you think about, I don't believe you're going to use a laptop in 3 years anymore. At least not for sort of personal use, because if you think about what a tablet can do already today and how long the battery lasts and how long it will last, you know, after two or three more generations, and you can attach a keyboard to it and so forth. So this traditional notebook, the traditional notebook architecture that's basically a downsized PC, is just so old. Traditional desktop operating systems will also go away, for sure. If you think about what that means for how consumer use devices and where they spend more time on, it's not mobile web, it's native apps. Yeah. So I think this combination of cloud services and native apps on mobile devices of varying form factors, from Apple Watch small, to iPhone 6, iPhone 6 Plus, tablet, and we will see 15 and 17-inch tablets as well, I think. Let me speak a little bit about the value of the brand, because this is often misunderstood. In almost any discussion with e-commerce, about e-commerce, I hear something like, well, will not Amazon own it all? No, Amazon won't own it all, because there's a whole bunch of strong retail brands that would never let their brand get totally diluted on Amazon. So there's really, if you think about e-commerce, there's Amazon and a couple of ankle biters who are trying to be in Amazon but will lose, such as the auto catalog, and the Neckermann has already lost, and some others went down the toilet. But then there are the brands, and the brands increasingly, using internet technology, find ways to sell to end consumers. And they open stores, and they are investing in omnichannel. So very interesting. So this will not go away as a market, is basically what I'm trying to say. And yes, I already alluded to it. I started something new. I answer questions about anything, but not about the new thing, because we are not there yet. Okay, and now I would like to open the Q&A session. Go ahead.
You mentioned that when you had Intershop, you did one actually big mistake starting at the German Stock Exchange before starting at the US Stock Exchange. Do you have any other things while being at Intershop where you thought, like, the next company I will do is definitely not doing the same mistakes again, and what kind of mistakes were these?
Well, this is the... The question was, aside from listing on the wrong stock exchange, what other big mistakes did I make, right?
Yeah.
This is,
yeah.
I mean, it's fair. So,
and
I mean,
also like where you thought, like, when
or
I
learnings.
Have the next company,
yeah.
I definitely don't do that mistakes again.
Let me say, this is the only big mistake I regret. Mm-hmm. Everything else, look, I was young, I knew nothing, I had to learn through mistakes, okay? And so, from this perspective, it's fine. Nowadays, it is, how should I say this? It is easier for me because I've seen many things before. I have more credibility, but at the same time, there might be someone who's more creative now than I am. So this is how it goes.
Thanks.
Do you think, to continue the question, do you think that being seen as a German company, irrespective of the stock options and the other things you mentioned, is it a negative to be a German company, to have a German?
Well, this is very specific for tech, and in particular for software or for internet services, because the largest market that is accessible to sort of a Western-educated entrepreneur is the U.S. I mean, China is a thing that's different. I mean, in many aspects, it's becoming a bigger market for it, but I think it's somewhat closed from a culture perspective. Yeah. And you know, in the internet, if you have a universally applicable service or a great idea, if you're not the market leader, you lose. And in order to become the market leader, you have to basically win in the biggest market. And if the biggest market is the U.S., then this is where you have to go. There are some other reasons why the U.S. is interesting. Among them, accessibility of venture capital, a nice sort of well socially accepted network between universities, VCs, entrepreneurs, and so forth. There's some other things that make it a more productive environment. It doesn't mean it's easier. The bar is relatively high. So I think for a German entrepreneur to go over there, it is possible, but it's initially very hard, but later you get a reward in the form of a functioning infrastructure that can support you.
I have a question. One of the partners in German Technology Entrepreneurship Center is the European School of Management and Technology, which is arguably the leading German MBA school. Is there something that could be taught better at MBA schools in order to maybe get people or graduates to be entrepreneurs rather than business consultants?
Well, I don't know this school very well, so this is not about a particular school. I can just say that many of the U.S. programs I've seen are much more pragmatic and focus on everyday issues that you encounter as an entrepreneur, whereas still there is a lot of sort of theoretical and old style teaching. Statistics and things that you never use in reality. So it is changing somewhat, in particular with business schools that are privately run, they're somewhat more pragmatic. However, for example, most of them don't do original research, so they're licensed cases from Harvard Business School or from Babson and so forth. So we are basically using the byproducts of what US programs do. And again, I'm hopeful because it's improving, but it's in particular, let me give you one example. Most good programs in the US at good universities, they teach leadership. So basically how to lead people. It's not the norm here in Germany.
How do you see the current trend that's picking up speed of big corporations and even some Mittelstand corporations to opening up to digital change, or starting accelerators or building internal design teams or trying to retrain their staff in order to adapt to methods we know from the startup industry? Do you think that's all nonsense? Do you think that this can actually achieve anything?
Well, I think it's great that it's being tried, but it's also very hard, because if you have a certain culture in the company, somehow it will always manage to find its way into this team that's trying to get something done. Yeah. It's great it's being tried, but it's not easy. It might be easier for those teams to just do it on their own and get maybe you know, a corporate investor from an interested company.
But is there any way to transform a corporate culture into a more entrepreneurial one? Have you ever seen it successful?
Of course it's possible, but it's taking so long that all your impatient entrepreneurs, you don't want to, you know, wait it out, I think. Oh, there's a huge business in education when it comes to e-commerce. It's just, you know, my company's never focused on that aspect, but it's a huge business. And it's going to be you know, even bigger in the future. And I think almost all industries are affected by it. And one example where that worked really well, 10 years ago, brands would sell through retail. They didn't have their own sales channel. No longer the case. In fact, in many cases, selling through their own outlets and online is more important to brand building and also to revenues in other channels than any other channel.
What do you think is the impact of social networking on e-commerce? Do you think that that somehow merges? Amazon is still not social at all.
This has been a hot topic for a couple of years now. While it is important for the reputation of products, it doesn't necessarily mean that everyone is comfortable basically shopping from within Facebook. This is sort of where it stands. So the big social network players, they're still trying to figure out what they can do to make e-commerce a significant revenue contributor. At the moment, it's nothing. It's more or less nothing. So advertising rules it. Yeah? However, one a player that may actually have the first, you know, winning strategy on it is Pinterest. So Pinterest, because it is not so in your face with like Facebook, with trying to connect everybody to everything and know everything about everyone. It's a little bit more hands off, but it's very visually oriented, and therefore it's a favorite for brands to display their product. And Pinterest just recently added, or is in the process of adding, a buy button that bypasses the entire shopping cart, so just make it really easy. It's just, you know, basically imagine Apple Pay, you know, two clicks and it's on its way to you. Yeah? With basically, there's a partnership even between Pinterest and Demandware around that. So this could be huge, I think. I like the idea. Okay. Just to repeat the question, this what is, as a business angel, what else besides e-commerce interests me? First of all, the thing I have the least of now that I'm back into the basically building a business is time. So I stopped doing any investments. Just can't manage it. The one I did outside is a company called Torquedo, which provides electric and hybrid propulsion systems for boats. It's basically Tesla for boats. You can look it up. It's called Torquedo.com. It's fun. It's hobby for me.
Is Demandware from other e-commerce platforms, Magento, lots and lots of others, software, XT-commerce, all these. So what would you could you share with us?
First of all, there's size and success.
Why Demandware?
I tried to explain this a couple minutes ago. It's a cloud-based and a shared success model. So we don't sell anything, and then let you basically figure out how to get this to work. We are a partner for our retailers. It is not just a software model. Whereas all the others you mentioned, in some shape or form, there are software models. We don't do software.
Yeah, you build big companies, and I assume that it's only possible with good people and good stuff. What do you think? How important is it compared with a business model, for example? And how did you find your partners or staff?
You know, I didn't find out in my own companies. I found out when I basically lost money on angel investments that it is a mistake to fall in love with the business model or the technology, because this can all be changed. But the people who are starting a company and the founding team, it's not so easy. If you need to change, if the change is needed there, then the money is basically already down the toilet. So it's extremely important that there is a great team. Because everything else you can fix. Yeah, if you learn along the way, okay, your first idea didn't work out, maybe you have to change it a little bit or try something entirely new. Which basically happened at my first company when this document imaging thing didn't fly. But we were able to build something really cool because we learned about the internet, which we hadn't learned, played with Next and all the new technologies. So I think great teams can recover. But it's too easy to just pitch an idea and then you're supposed to say whether this is a great company. And you can't. Yeah. Well, you know, I'm self-taught because the type of education that I would have wanted wasn't available to me. If it's available, then I would have, I mean, I can only recommend to take it. Yeah, I mean, it's great what's available. And I did go back to school later. I went to a Harvard three-year Harvard program when I had the time to do it. Finished it 2 years ago. So. I'm all for it. I mean, business education. Walter, are you still there somewhere? I guess he left. But one of the, one of my friends, he is, has been a Harvard professor, and he's doing basically business education for a living. It's great. There's a lot to learn, and you can probably skip a few costly mistakes that way. You had a question.
I forgot.
Okay.
But I might have another one. Talking about education, would you actually mind to change to share what you learned in form of like courses or whatsoever, like being part of? Okay.
Maybe later, but for the next 5, 6, 7, 8 years, I'm busy. Yeah.
Okay.
I did have some time, and I did teach, mostly in the U.S. A little bit in. I'm sponsoring a chair at the Fachhochschule Jena for e-commerce. So this.
I have a follow-up question for this question, which is basically an integrated team. How do I find the best team members? Where did you find the most the best people for your team, and also the best investors?
Well, the best team members. This is, to some degree, where your entrepreneurial talent comes in, because you have to be able to sell a vision to really, really good potential team members, and you have to be able to basically keep them motivated. You can learn some of this, of course, but this is much of this piece of it has to be sort of in you. And I mean, there are systematic ways to get to know great people. For example, you could do an MBA at a business school where you know great minds meet, like MIT Sloan. I know many in the Boston area. Just know that many teams, basically three or four people, come straight out of MIT Sloan to start a company, and they have never met before. They met during the MBA, so this might be a way.
And then, if you talk lead generation, so selling is clear, but then you need to create the leads. So MBA is one idea, but it takes a lot of time. If I want to accelerate, do you have any advice?
The founder is the chief talent officer, okay? So you have to deploy everything you've got to find the best people. There is no one size fits all. It depends on whether you have resources or not. I mean, if you have money, you can use recruiters, but still you have to convince the, if you don't have money, you have to kind of be very good at networking. Sure, yeah.
You have to know today what a person will do, maybe in 1 year.
Well, you can try it out, and everybody makes mistakes. I make mistakes too. Not everybody works out.
So you said you have no time next half year. What's your focus? Is it team, product, sales, marketing, strategy?
Pretty much.
Everything.
But right now we have no product, so we're building product. So there's a lot of focus on that.
Thank you so much, Stephan.
Yeah, thank you.